Hey guys, Adam Lobo here from Adam Lobo TV, and in this video, I'll be giving you my in-depth review of the POCO X3 GT after using it for about a week and a half as my daily smartphone, and I'll answer all of your questions that you've asked me in my first impressions video throughout the video and at the end of this video as well. So keep watching. Now, since the unboxing was done in my previous video of the phone, let's recap on the specs. The POCO X3 GT comes with a MediaTek Dimensity 1100 5G 6nm chipset with the Mali G77MC9 GPU. The variant that I have is the 8GB of RAM with 256GB of storage. Backed with Android 11, it is shipped with MIUI 12.5 skin. And as of the recording of this video, it is using version 12.5.1 POCO skin. Now, as for the phone's design and build quality, nothing to really shout about, honestly. And there's also nothing to complain about using it daily, so that was good news. In terms of finish, this Stargaze Black variant was more like a silver to a black color gradient. It had like tiny little glitter dots inside of the gloss surface, hence the Stargaze name. But it was quite a fingerprint magnet, and based on what I saw online, I'm predicting that the wave blue color might also be a fingerprint magnet, but I have a feeling that the cloud white version might not have such things to worry about. Then the camera bump looked like a refreshing and a new design, which was nice, with a medium-sized thickness, but it didn't wobble during typing on the surface, only towards the middle left of the phone. As for the ports and buttons, looking now below, other than the USB-C port, you'll find one of the speaker grills over there. On the right, there is the power button, which doubles up as a side-mounted fingerprint sensor, which I've always been a fan compared to the concave style of the power button, so that was nice. Then you'll find the volume rockers on top. Then on the left, there is the SIM ejector slot, which supports up to 2 SIMs, and there's no micro SD card slot expansion, so keep that in mind if you're one of those who really needs one. Then finally on top, there is the IR blaster and the second speaker grill over there, since this phone is a stereo speaker. So as mentioned, using the phone daily felt great. I had no complaints about the phone, and because of its not so unique finish, I would give the phone a B+ for the overall design and the build quality. So in my first impressions video, I went extremely deep on the screen. So I'm here to let you guys know just on how the screen performs when I was using it daily. Now, as a recap, the phone screen is a 6.6-inch FHD+ display with a resolution of 1080 by 2400 pixels. And as mentioned in my previous video, I still think that this is hands down the best looking IPS LCD display compared to any other smartphones, especially within this price range. And yes, even beating the infamous Xiaomi Mi 20 Pro in terms of the IPS display quality. And I did see some comments trashing the phone about, "Ooh, it's IPS, not AMOLED." Which I've proven in my comparison video that the AMOLED screen on the Redmi Note 10 Pro is not as good as the Mi 20 Pro, which uses an IPS LCD display. So guys, I am here to tell you that not all AMOLED screens are created equal, and there are IPS LCD panels that can be better than AMOLED screens. And I also suspect the reason why this screen looks better than other IPS panels, it is also because of the fact that it has the Corning Gorilla Glass Victus, the toughest and the highest quality glass from Corning, which is totally unheard of for smartphones within this price range to even have. Now, what's extra sweet is that it comes with a high refresh rate of 120Hz with a touch sampling rate of 240Hz, which again, for the price, is an extremely big deal. And since it has DCI P3 color gamut, watching videos on YouTube was extremely satisfying. But one thing to note, which I didn't even realize it, that on Netflix, the playback was at Widevine L3, so the maximum resolution was at SD, which I did not get why, so let's hope a software update could fix that problem. Then in terms of using the phone daily, whether or not it's indoors or outdoors, the screen was really bright and it was very usable. Once again, you can't even tell that this is an IPS LCD display because it looks so nice and bright during any lighting conditions. So for the phone screen, I would give an A- because of the whole Netflix playback. But other than that, it is indeed a very good screen and surely one of the biggest plus factors of the phone. So as for your questions about the visibility of the edge of the screen, Muhammad Shafiq, I personally did not even notice that edges when I was using the phone daily. Now onto the phone's cameras. For the rear, you'll find a 64 megapixel f1.8 aperture 26mm wide main lens, an 8 megapixel f2.2 ultra wide lens, and a 2 megapixel f2.4 macro lens. Then as for the front camera, it has a 16 megapixel f2.5 aperture lens. Now starting from the high 64 megapixel mode, it performed well with very great details on the images, and of course giving you flexibility in post, but I wouldn't use this mode too much since there is no micro SD card slot expansion. As for the main lens, the overall dynamic range and the colors were great both when taking photos when the light is shining towards my favor and also against the light, which overall I have to say I loved how the images looked over here. In terms of zooming, since there's no dedicated telephoto lens, so you'll be able to zoom only digitally, but up to 10 times, which as usual I wouldn't recommend due to the image quality, but still there is an option. Then I have to say that I really love the portrait mode for the rear cameras, where the details and the subject to background blur was extremely flagship level quality, as you guys can see in these images. Then the ultra wide angle shots were also great with no barrel distortions on the edges, but I did see a little loss of detail and light if you compare directly with the main lens. Where as seen over here in this back-to-back shots using the ultra-wide angle lens and the main lens, you'll see there's more details and a slightly better vibrant colors on the main lens compared to the ultra-wide angle lens. Then as for the macro lens, while a lot of people complain on my previous video about how macro lenses were extremely important to y'all, so yes, I did a test on that and the images turned out just okay. Where I felt that it was pretty hard to nail focus over here, but the colors were pretty consistent compared to the other lenses. Then as for the night mode shots, it was pretty much the same with the main lens and the ultra wide angle lens, where the main lens performed better. So I would totally use the main lens as much as I can for any type of situations when taking photos, whether or not it's at night or even during the day. Then as for the selfie photos, I have to say that I did not really like how the photos turned out over here, because you really need to angle the phone towards the light to make sure that the photos are not overexposed. So that was not a really good thing. And if you do really get a nicely lit shots, it tend to over soften my forehead, even though I got the beauty mode turned off as seen at my forehead area. Then the subject to background blur was good for the portrait selfie, but then again, my forehead looked like it was painted right in the middle as seen in these photos. Next, looking at the video recording, the rear camera records up to 4K 30 frames per second with great quality with decent stabilization. But the stabilization was really good for the ultra wide angle lens, but it only maxes out at 1080p at 30 frames per second. Then as for the front camera, it records up to 1080p up to 30 frames per second. And here's where I accidentally unlocked a hack where I would like to share with y'all. So by default, the image stabilization for the video looked pretty unstable, as you guys can see, because of the HDR toggle was turned on when I was taking videos in the app. But if you were to turn it off, it immediately gives you a way better stabilized shots, and it was the same for the rear camera when it comes to recording 4K video as well. So here's where I wished that POCO left that turned off, because I'm sure we all would prefer a better and a more stabilized video compared to having HDR, right? So keep that in mind, guys. So overall, I would rate the main lens to be the best for photos and the ultra wide lens for videos. The front camera for me wasn't the best trade, but for the price of this phone, I am willing to compromise on that. So there's your answer, Herbert Uzael, Raymond Fernando, and Elmer Villamora. Now as for the phone sound quality, it comes with stereo speakers as seen earlier, one below and one on top. Now the volume was pretty good, not the loudest, but considering the price range, it did not really affect me once again. Now the low ends were less apparent, but it did sound nicer on the mids to highs, especially on the high vocal frequency, and here is a quick sound test. Now, if you guys are enjoying this video so far, a nice big thumbs up would be very much appreciated, and subscribe to Adam Lobo TV if you like this kind of content. That would also be very much lovely. Now, in terms of software, it comes with Android 11 with MIUI POCO skin version 12.5.1 at this point in time. And yes, the absolute good news is that this POCO version of the MIUI is so much better than the non-POCO devices, because the overall UI and the navigation were great. The control center by swiping towards the right and the notification menu by swiping towards the top left are now turned on by default, instead of going into the settings and diving further to activate that like how it was on the POCO F3. So for those of you who corrected me about how it was there and I did not activate it, well, I did mention in the comments that I know you need to activate it, but my point was that these features should be already activated by default, right? Now, while I don't talk a lot about haptics in my phone reviews, but I found it to be great on the phone, and there were also incremental stuff which I also loved, like the larger notification rows when the screen is locked, the Google feed when swiped towards the left of the home screen, and once again the overall navigation. And I didn't encounter any lag or any apps being shut down when I was using the phone daily for the past 1.5 weeks. So yes, I do use this phone as my main device and put my SIM card inside, not a secondary phone, to really experience the phone properly. And I'm happy to also note that this POCO issues has no issues whatsoever during my usage. Now, as for the phone's battery, the phone comes with 5000 milliamps of battery, and here is where I was not so pleased with the battery performance on the phone, which is probably the only drawback that I see on the phone as well. At first, the battery drained pretty slowly, and I could get about 1 hour and 4 minutes or so when I was at 90% battery, so I was like, ooh, that was nice. Because it kind of reminded me of how the Mi 10T Pro was, which has an amazing battery life. And while it did stay consistent throughout my usage, there were two scenarios when the battery drained very quickly. Firstly, when I reached about 40%+, and then secondly, when I was playing games for a really long time. And based on my daily usage, I got an average of 4 hours and 10 minutes of screen on time when I was at 10% battery, sometimes a little more screen on time, or sometimes even less. So let's hope for a software update to get this lower percentage battery drain to an optimum level. But of course, to counter this problem, the phone comes with a massive 67 watt that could get your phone charged from 0 to 100% in about 35 minutes or so, which does balance out the whole less screen on time issue. But then again, maybe it's just me, but I do prefer a longer screen on time than fast charging any day. But let me know what you guys think. Which one would you choose? Better screen on time or faster charging? Let me know down below. Now, in terms of gaming, I was very pleased with the overall gaming performance. Firstly, on PUBG Mobile, it ran smoothly at HDR graphics and frame rate set to ultra. Then on a graphic intensive game like Genshin Impact, it also ran smoothly with no overheating issues or any micro lag at a medium settings at 60 frames per second with motion blur turned off. There's no overall battery drain except when it reached about 40% onwards, as mentioned earlier, but other than that, it ran very well over here. Now, in conclusion, I have to say this. While I really love the direction that POCO is heading towards all of their smartphones, I personally think, that they should take a step back on releasing too many smartphones under the same POCO brand to not make it more confusing for consumers, and make one or two very strong devices to make it easier for you and for me to make a purchase. But then again, you still have me to test out all of these devices to help you make a purchase decision. But that being said, I still love the direction that POCO is heading compared to what OnePlus has gone from never settle to totally settled, and I feel that POCO as a brand is indeed doing lots of great things for the smartphones, especially with such an affordable price. As for the phone's price in Malaysia, it starts from a really great price of 1,299 ringgit for the 8GB of RAM with 128GB storage variant, and is priced at 1,599 ringgit for the 8GB of RAM with 256GB of storage, and I'll leave links down below for you guys to get yourself one. Now let's end the video by some of the other questions that you've asked me in my first impressions video. Firstly, we have Xyron PUBG Mobile glass back. Nope, it is plastic, especially considering the price. Firon Jin from Thailand. Sorry if I did not get your name pronounced properly. How's the speakerphone? How's the microphone and the speaker volume function of the phone? Well, I did test out the speaker volume as seen in the video, so that was pretty much good. But based on me using the phone daily, the speaker phone was nice and loud, and because of the fact that it is a stereo speakers, there was no issues on the microphones and the overall speakers, especially when I got any callings done or any phone calls done. So that, my friend, was pretty much great. Next, Mohammad Ali 92 asks, Sangka POCO Malaysia launch POCO F3 GT rupa-rupanya POCO X3 GT. Ha ha ha, POCO Malaysia please launch juga POCO F3 GT. Saya pun harap kalau Malaysia boleh launch POCO F3 GT. Kalau ada launch dekat Malaysia, confirm I akan buat review, so don't worry. Now, Shiva Jit says, it's not launching in India, sad cry face. That sucks, man. I kind of got confirmation that it's not being launched in India, but who knows, there might be. I think they might be releasing in a different name, but sorry to hear that, my dear friend. And then there's one interesting comment coming from Hemant Sharma. Sounds like a paid review. All 120Hz refresh rate have the spec sheet and is repeated in every other phone. Oh, really? Tell me which smartphone which has this high refresh rate has Corning Gorilla Glass Victus and comes with this kind of smartphone price. I challenge you to tell me which other smartphone has that. Bibak asks, so is this phone better than the POCO F3? And then _YAS also asked me the same question. Well, I asked y'all on my YouTube community tab whether or not I should do a comparison between this phone against the Realme GTO, the POCO F3, and y'all vote for me to go with the comparison video between the POCO F3 with this particular smartphone. So stay tuned for that video comparison coming really soon. Aside from that, thank you so much for watching. Hope you guys enjoyed this video, and do let me know if you guys are planning to get the POCO X3 GT down at the comment section below, and let's discuss down there.